Now that we've started writing our data reference and have the config string implemented, we'll move on and look at what it takes to actually start returning values from our data reference. I want to start by going into System Explorer and thinking about the process by which we arrive at this mass share attribute that we configured in our tank farm. So if we go and look at the graphical settings here, we know that our data reference needs a couple of inputs in order to get values. Okay, so imagine a case where for all of my tanks, I want to know the mass share. Not unreasonable, right? So I call tank 1. And I ask, what is your mass share? Well, as inputs, it needs its own mass, which is a series of formulas, and then it needs to know the total mass of the tank farm. Well, the total mass of the tank farm, you'll recall, is a rollup. What does that rollup want? It wants to know the mass of all three tanks. So far, in this one call for mass share, it looks like I'm going to trigger the mass of tank 1, the mass of tank 2, the mass of tank 3, and then again, the mass of tank 1, if we're not smart. Then when I go on to tank 2, to get its mass share, I'll need to calculate the mass of tank 2, and then I'll need to calculate the mass of tank 1, tank 2, and tank 3 all over again, and so on and so forth. Of course, that's kind of a nightmare situation, and we want to avoid that. The AFSDK provides a way to avoid duplicating calls for inputs as a method of the data reference called getInputs. In other words, if I ask for values from a list of attributes, before I start even getting their values, first we want to know what their inputs are. So our data reference can tell the SDK all the list of references that it needs. The SDK can crawl that list and figure out really the dependency tree and the order that it wants to execute these things in. So when I call for the mass share of tank 1, tank 2, and tank 3, I'm not repeating any data calls. I'm only having to calculate each of their mass once and not many, many times. So in the SDK, this way that we, or in our data reference, the way that we tell the SDK what inputs we need is implemented as a virtual method that we can override. So we will override the getInputs method. The input of this data reference will be whatever our target attribute is. For right now, though, I would like us to take the simpler case of assuming that we want the value of our parent attribute. In other words, if I want to know whether or not I'm in a communication failure state, for the communication failure attribute, I will set this to our new bitmask data reference, and it will just look one level above it at its parent attribute, which is that quality string. Right now, we will assume that as the kind of easy case and come back later and fully implement this. So for right now, the one input that we will use is the parent attribute of the current attribute. The return type is an AF attribute list object, so we'll make a new one of those. And to that list, we will add our parent attribute. Our current class is a data reference, which gets associated with an individual attribute. So my class has an AF attribute associated with it. And that attribute, in turn, we are going to assume has a parent. Right? Again, this is the general and easy case that we are implementing right now. Later in this series of videos, we will come back and implement the general case of going to any target attribute. For right now, go to our parent attribute and specify that that is the input whose values I need to execute my data reference. So anytime someone asks for values from my data reference, we will tell the SDK that if you want values for example, communication failure, we will need to know what the value is for quality, because that's the string that we need to parse apart. And with that, the getInputs method is implemented. We will continue by looking at how to use these inputs during a getValues data call.